So you heard from Dr. Khan about the new paradigm about treatment as prevention and treatment as treatment, and the evidence that we have that is abundant that we should get people on treatment right away. So why do we really need PrEP if we have such a powerful tool as treating HIV-infected people? Well, the problem, and this is a slide also that Dr. Khan showed, but a little bit different take, which is basically the trends are in the right direction in the sense that there are fewer infections now than there were a decade ago occurring every year, but there's still close to 2 million new HIV infections globally. In the US, there are about 40,000 infections a year. The rate is not going down fast enough, and because the death rate is also going down, but going down slowly, we actually have more new infections than we have more deaths. Good to have fewer deaths, but it also means that there are more people living with HIV now than at any previous time in the epidemic. So that's really why we need to talk about PrEP. And then when we think about demographics in the US, and certainly true here in Puerto Rico, the two key populations where the epidemic is growing most rapidly in the U.S. are Black and Latino men who have sex with men, particularly between the ages of 25 and 34. So there's really a critical need for preventive interventions for the population. So how many people in the room have prescribed PrEP previously? Just curious. So there are a few people, but not a whole lot. So my intent today is to convince those of you who can prescribe to realize that PrEP is something that we all can do. It's not something that is just the province of one group of physicians or healthcare providers or another. So this slide basically summarizes the efficacy trials of PrEP, the randomized controlled trials of tenofovir, disopyroxil fumarate, and emtricitabine. And that's been the primary regimen that's been studied for PrEP up until now. At the end, we'll talk about what's coming down the pike. You know, so what the take home from the slide is that on the x-axis, you can see adherence, on the y-axis, effectiveness. And basically, if you take the medication consistently, efficacy is extremely high. Now, people said, well, you know, even at the highest level, it was 86% with intent to treat. That's not so great. And maybe in the real world, people will be less adherent. But it actually turns out in the real world, when people know that if they take a pill on a daily basis, they will be protected, the efficacy is in the very high 90s, well over 99% really in some of the analyses. So PrEP is highly effective when taken consistently. Then the next question is it safe? We're giving otherwise healthy people medication. And looking at the randomized control studies, doing a meta-analysis, basically, there was not a significant difference between TDF-based PrEP versus placebo for virtually all side effects. You know, things like headache were not any more significant. There is a small startup syndrome, and a minority of individuals may have GI distress, but that tends to be transient and self-limited, does not lead to study medication discontinuation. Changes in creatinine are something that we see with TDF. It's more pronounced in older patients. It is immediately reversible, and that's why we recommend routine creatinine monitoring. There is a decrease in bone mineral density that does happen, that was seen in IPREX sub-study and in subsequent studies, but this is a clinically insignificant but statistically significant difference. In other words, there's not an increase in fractures. There's not any clinical findings associated with this, but certainly it's something to be monitored. Certainly if we had a patient with osteopenia, patient had some other reason for bone disease, we would be concerned. And there are other alternatives potentially coming down the pike in the future. Then the other issue is PrEP, can it be truly 100% effective? And the answer is no. Very few things we have in medicine that are 100% effective, but it's close to it. So what has been described in the literature are case reports of individuals who appeared to be adherent. And in most of these cases, the clinicians thought enough at the time that a person who was on PrEP seroconverted that they took a blood sample and they're able to establish that there was medication on board consistent with being adherent to the medication. Now, in the majority of those cases, these were individuals infected with resistant virus. But one case was a person infected with a susceptible strain. This was an individual in the Netherlands, had multiple receptive anal sexual encounters, had recurrent rectal STIs, and it is conceivable that the medication, even with protective levels on board, was overwhelmed in the setting of chronic rectal inflammation. That's one case with hundreds of thousands of individuals now having been on PrEP over the last few years. So they are the case reports, but they are extremely rare. Another issue that clinicians have been worried about is this issue of risk compensation, or so-called behavioral disinhibition. And this is the old idea: if you put seatbelts in cars, will people drive faster? You know, are you creating a what people call a perverse incentive for people to be risky? Well, the issue is that people are taking PrEP because they are risky. It's not that PrEP is making them risky. So in the best case scenario, this quote risky person is adherent to PrEP. There's no HIV transmission. And so there's not a downside in terms of their protection against HIV if they're adherent. There certainly is a worst case scenario, and that has happened, but extremely rarely, which is somebody who's taking the medication intermittently, starting and stopping. And if somebody stops the medication, becomes infected, then starts the medication, because it's two drugs and not three drugs, they can select for resistant strains. That has been described, exceedingly rare. So we have to really match our counseling messages and prevention interventions to risk. Now, again, we're talking about, for the most part, in this part of the world, we're talking about mainly sexual transmission of HIV, and therefore we have to worry about bacterial sexually transmitted infections. So these are data that we looked at Fenway Health. So for those who are not familiar, Fenway Health is a community health center in Boston. It serves a diverse population, but has a large LGBT healthcare component. About half the patients are sexual and gender minority patients. As Dr. Tamayo mentioned, we were one of the original sites to study PrEP with the CDC safety study and then the IPREC study. So we've been prescribing PrEP even before the FDA approved it. You can see in the red, those are people who are HIV uninfected and on PrEP. But what this graph shows you is there's a lavender line that's going up that you can see starting in 2005, where the number of STIs diagnosed at Fenway was about 200 cases a year, either gonorrhea, syphilis, or chlamydia. It was up over 1,300 cases by 2015, so quite a significant increase over time. Then when you say who was becoming infected with one of these bacterial STIs, the green bars are HIV uninfected individuals who are not on PrEP. The red bars were HIV uninfected individuals on PrEP, and the blue are HIV infected individuals who by definition would not be getting PrEP. So what you can see is that the green and the blue bars are decreasing, and that a larger segment are people on PrEP. So certainly people on PrEP are associated with a substantial number of STIs, but they're not the only people with STIs. And in point of fact, the people in the green bar are people who are HIV uninfected with STIs. And we know that those are individuals now at high risk for becoming HIV infected. So we'd like to see more of the red bar, but we don't, we can't forget the fact that individuals who are using PrEP, who are not using condoms, are at high risk for STIs. So the best treatment we have for that is frequent screening, rapid treatment, partner notification, all the public health measures we have for STIs in the past. The U.S. Public Health Service, CDC, has very specific guidances, and PrEP is not a very complicated thing for any clinician to do. First, you want to establish that the person's not HIV infected. New York City Health Department has done a program of same-day PrEP, and they've shown that in screening more than 1,000 people who are at high risk for HIV, there were only four individuals who, after they started PrEP, they had to stop because two were acutely infected. In other words, they had had a rapid HIV test that was negative, but they did RNA pooling, and they found two were viremic out of these 1,000 high-risk people, and two individuals had a creatinine come back the next day that was such that they should not be on TDF. So that's easily, again, monitored, and so there's not a reason not to start PrEP same day, again, when the patient's ready. But if somebody's ready to start on a specific day, certainly having an algorithm to do rapid testing with a reflex to do a more sensitive test very quickly, being able to screen for creatinine and evaluating renal function and STIs. Then the current recommendation is one pill once a day, and we'll talk a little bit more about on-demand PrEP. We still want to tell people to use condoms and do risk reduction counseling, but not in a moralistic way. We want to be able to say to people, we want to support your plan for your sexual health, but keep in mind, PrEP will, antiretroviral PrEP will not protect you against bacterial STIs. There has been a study in France looking at post-exposure doxycycline. The study has been controversial many quarters because it did show a decrease in syphilis and a decrease in chlamydia, but not a decrease in gonorrhea. And with concerns about multi-drug resistant gonorrhea, some centers, people are a little uneasy. That study is being replicated on the West Coast in Seattle and in San Francisco, so we'll see whether whether the findings continue to hold. But certainly that would be another option, be post-exposure for STIs. But again, the question is pill burden for individuals for things that where they don't have the infection, but to protect them from an infection. Then in terms of monitoring, the recommendation is quarterly HIV testing with risk assessment counseling. We'll talk a little bit more about new ways of doing the monitoring. The recommendation now is every 6 months renal function, unless there's a reason to think somebody may have more of a risk for renal dysfunction. And the guidance says up to 6 months for STI screening, but certainly people who are sexually active, we'd recommend quarterly screening as well. The guidance is available on the CDC website. Just if you keyword PrEP guidelines, you'll be able to download it. In terms of the recommendations, what's interesting is, Pedro showed some of the guidance, some of the when to start kind of guidance in the past. Here, what we have is the CDC says it's daily dosing, US FDA says daily dosing, but the ISUSA and now the World Health Organization, as of this summer, said on-demand PrEP is also an option. So on-demand PrEP is based on a study conducted by the French and also done in Quebec. And this regimen was telling individuals, if you're not having sex on a regular basis, you know, several times a week, what you should do is, if you know you're going to have sex at a certain time, within 24 hours of intercourse, take one pill within 24 hours and another pill within 2 hours of sex, and then a pill a day for the next 2 days afterwards. So four pills for each condomless sexual event, not more than eight pills a week. And they found in the study, the Hypergay study, that it was very well tolerated. There was a little higher incidence of GI upset for some individuals, again, not leading to drug discontinuation. Very high levels of new STIs, so a very risky population. This was a very highly adherent and relatively sexually active population. So individuals averaged at least one sex act a week, and the number of pills a month was averaged about 15. So very close to what is consistent with protective levels, taking at least four pills a week. So it's proof of concept that on-demand PrEP can work, because when they looked at the open label extension, which is what OLE stands for there, basically they found a 97% risk reduction in HIV incidence. This regimen has been approved now for comparable use in Canada, in France, in several countries in Europe, including the Netherlands. So definitely a possibility. So what we have in the US, though, and certainly my understanding is here in Puerto Rico, that there's a fair lack of use in people who might benefit. We did an online survey. We're able to enroll almost 5,000 individuals. We found that this was a very risky population. And although most of the people had heard of PrEP, we still found a year and a half ago, a fifth had not heard of PrEP, and most had not used it. Only about 15% of people had used it. The reasons for non-use varied. Older MSM felt that side effects were their biggest concern. For black MSM, for less educated MSM, MSM outside the United States, there were other concerns, things like concerns about effects on insurance, the costs, and medical providers' reaction. So again, we are sometimes part of the problem. We know that there are significant racial and sexual disparities. So women are underutilizing PrEP in relative to their relative risk, because certainly we still have about 25 to 30% of new infections overall in the United States, and I believe a higher percentage on the island of new HIV infections are among women, so we need to have culturally tailored programs, and certainly black and Latino MSM are underutilizing. Another issue is PrEP persistence, getting people to stay on the medication. after initiating it. Some discontinuation makes sense. Unlike antiretroviral therapy, PrEP does not have to be for life. If somebody's not risky after a period of time, there's no need for them to be taking medication. The challenge is people gauging their risk. If somebody's not risky and then becomes risky later, do they know enough to reinitiate PrEP at a certain point in time? I was asked to sort of talk a little bit about what's going on elsewhere in the region, and there is a program, the MPREP program now, that's an open label program for PrEP access in Brazil, Mexico, and Peru, with very good rates of continuation, except in Peru. In Peru in particular, they found that it was transgender women that had the lowest rates of continuation, and found that poverty, sex work were associated with non-continuation. So clearly, it's not just giving people a pill, it's also dealing with the social, structural issues in their lives that's important. When in Atlanta, a cohort of black MSM was looked at, what were the reasons for discontinuation or the factors associated with discontinuation? Multivariable analysis found being of younger age, people using marijuana, having a recent STI, so that would suggest risk, but then people who were having fewer partners also independently were at risk. So the people who are having fewer sexual partners, that makes sense, but for the other factors, clearly we have to have programs that are tailored for race, ethnicity, for age, and for other key population factors. So there are some things that have been going on in the past few years. There's HP10073, which was a black MSM demonstration project conducted in Los Angeles, Washington, and Chapel Hill, North Carolina. And this involved a client-centered care coordination approach. So these were peers that were trained to work with individuals and to help support their adherence to PrEP. The good news was that the majority of individuals who were offered PrEP accepted it, and retention in the study was very high. It was a small study, but it still had 5 seroconverters among people who accepted PrEP. And that led to, that was associated with almost a 3% incidence. This was a lower incidence than what might have been expected for this population, but still higher than what's acceptable. So this is the beginning of something, but has to be improved and iterated on. In terms of adolescents, there are a number of issues. We were involved in a study conducted in 6 cities in the US, ATN 110, and a parallel study for younger, even younger MSM, age 15 to 17, ATN 113. And adherence was the big challenge. The first part of the protocol, the youth were asked to come in every month, and they initially got a behavioral intervention, either a group intervention or an individualized intervention. And for the first quarter, adherence was up over 50%. Still not optimal, but not as bad. It plummeted when visits went to be quarterly. So it may suggest that youth may need more frequent visits. The question now is whether using new technologies can maintain engagement in PrEP care. The other issue is, and I don't know what the laws are here on the island in terms of emancipated minors. In other words, if youth are accessing PrEP, do parents have to be involved or not? In states like Massachusetts, that's not necessarily the case. Then the other population I mentioned that where there are concerns about access to PrEP are transgender women in PrEP. In the IPREC study, there was a small number of transgender women who were enrolled in the study, and it turned out that HIV incidence did not differ between the women who got placebo and the transgender women who got the active medication. So people said, maybe it doesn't work in transgender women. Maybe the hormones interact with the medication. The post-hoc analysis found that adherence rates were extremely low in transgender women in the study. That, again, the studies that enroll men who have sex with men and transgender women are not culturally tailored, and maybe a turnoff for transgender women as opposed to trying to culturally tailor interventions for a very different population. Because the post-hoc analysis found that those transgender women that had medication levels consistent with 4 pills a week, they were protected. And actually, when people look at the drug interactions, the hormones will affect tenofovir levels, will decrease it modestly up to about 15%. So this speaks to the need for transgender women to be highly adherent to PrEP on a daily basis. The reverse is not the case. In other words, tenofovir has no effect, or emtricitabine, on hormones. So one thing we can tell transgender women who are using hormonal affirmative therapy, we can say the medication, PrEP is not going to affect your medication for your gender-affirming care, and I think that's an important message to have. So running down to in moments, if I can have a few extra seconds just to talk very quickly about the PrEP cascade. There are a number of things we can do to improve outcomes. One is the drug assistance programs. So the cost of PrEP care is not just the cost of the medication, it's the cost of the provider's visits, the STD screening. So there are several states in the US that provide drug assistance programs that support the other costs of the PrEP package, because although Gilead has a drug assistance program, there sometimes are not assistance for these other factors. There's academic detailing. The New York Department of Health has been very creative in training providers to go to talk to other providers about PrEP. Electronic health records, I'll show you a very quick example of how we, as we now have electronic health records in many hospitals, other systems, we can use those in a more intelligent way to help identify who are good PrEP candidates. People like Rupa Patel have been training pharmacists to be able to deliver PrEP in walk-in clinics, training peer navigators. There's been success with that. There are websites available globally to get generic PrEP in different quarters. I'm involved in study with my colleague Aaron Siegler to see whether people can be monitored at home so they don't have to come into the clinic every 3 months. They can do telemedicine with providers and get a kit, like an Amazon kit, self-swab for the STIs and prick your finger for syphilis and creatinine and HIV testing, and then get your results through an app. So I mentioned providers are an issue because a lot of times providers don't own PrEP. So my colleague Doug Krakauer called this the purview paradox, which means that for providers, primary care providers will say, these are fancy drugs, I don't really know how to use them, it should be the HIV specialist. The HIV specialists say, I don't take care of HIV uninfected individuals, so it should be the generalists who do that. So owning PrEP is part of the issue. Electronic health records, there were two articles in Lancet HIV in July. I'd recommend it for those who are interested. They both looked at using EHRs to identify potential PrEP candidates. Julia Marcus did her study in the Bay Area, and then my colleague Doug Krakauer did work at an HMO in Boston and at Fenway Health. And basically, what Julia's study and then Doug's study both found is there are a lot of things that will tell you whether somebody's a PrEP candidate, like a rectal SDI screen, for example, or somebody who's on opiate substitution therapy. You should think about, or being treated for syphilis, or has stimulant use issues. So in their model, they looked at people who became HIV infected in these HMOs, and they found that the models could predict 44% of the HIV seroconversions. So that would mean that, for men that is, and that would mean you could use these indicators to say, let's have a conversation with this person about PrEP. The trouble is for women, the models did not work well because for women, the challenge we have is identifying the partner who's gonna put the woman at risk, and EHR is not gonna tell you that. There are a bunch of online PrEP tools, and these slides will be available. I'm just rushing through in the interest of time. A number of different tools online that are available. There's a provider education hotline, a PrEP line that the CDC and UCSF has for consultation. So again, nobody is ever more than a phone call or internet link away from being able to have questions answered about PrEP. The use of new technologies is something that, with my colleague Katie Biello and I, we've been working on. So there was a study several years ago in Kenya that said if you did two-way text messaging once a week, that was associated with the viral load reduction for HIV-infected people. So now we're trying to determine what's the sweet spot in terms of getting people onboarded for PrEP and also getting people to be adherent to PrEP. And the reason we think the new technology is so important is that a lot of our patients are meeting their partners online. So having another app that might help you with your PrEP would be the way to go. But lastly, we have to think about the fact that we have to have programs around behavioral health too, because people who may be at risk for HIV may have other coexisting syndemic issues that need to be addressed if we're going to optimize PrEP care. There's a variety of other approaches ahead, potentially a second oral PrEP medication. There's been application to the FDA, and the Antiviral Advisory Committee made its recommendation for men-o-sex men and transgender women for Descovy, FTAF. But there are other things coming down the pipeline, antibodies, injectables, and preventive vaccines, but not quite there, and a vaginal ring that had modest efficacy that is being evaluated by European regulators for potential approval. Last point, the other opportunity for those of you who do primary care is PrEP can be a gateway to primary care. Just like women for hormonal contraception can be the beginning of a conversation about primary care for women's health, We did a study at Fenway. We looked at people who were at high risk for HIV, people who had rectal STI screens, for example, and we compared those who were on PrEP and those who weren't on PrEP, and published this in the American Journal of Public Health a few months ago. And we found that PrEP users were more likely to get flu vaccines, be screened for tobacco, be screened for depression, have diabetes screening. In other words, more engagement in primary care by virtue of or association with being on PrEP. So this just sort of summarizes, it's not just the pill, and we can't just only focus on PrEP. We have to think about treatment, because everything foundational is around testing. And with that, I'd like to thank you for your attention.